Hi, my name is John. I'm a recovering car salesman.
Hi, John.
Thank you. Thanks to God's grace and the fact that I work my program one day at a time, I have not found it necessary to sell a car today, nor for the last 24 years. For that, I am grateful. Being a car salesman was not exactly a reason to shoot myself, but it was close. There were fond memories, but just as many bad ones. There was always that customer or that boss or that coworker. The best part was the tight-knit group we had over the years. All had nicknames. Big Daddy, Lid, Bogus, Peter Paul, Moon, Mats, Hambone, and more. Colorful names with personalities to match. I was Ren 10-10, the doghouse lawyer. You'd call me Ren 10 for short. It was reflective of my being the first shaggy dog long hair to indoctrinate into the group. I was later Blonde John, then Blondie, and ultimately Blonde, sticking well into gray hair and baldness. I love the story behind each one of those nicknames, particularly Matt's, but I digress. We were bad to play pranks on one another, particularly the newbies. When you were the victim, the key was, no matter what, don't come unglued. It was such a critical element of rookie survival, they even covered it in the training. Don't come unglued, you'll avoid becoming a regular target. Come unglued, it's all but certain. Or you could do what Moon did. He emerged from training, entered the showroom, and promptly challenged Bogus in front of the group. You can't make me come unglued. Oh, don't say that. Bogus was the penultimate prankster. He was in a league of his own. Many tried in utter futility to get him to come unglued. It never happened. Moon alone was the only one who was ever bold enough to try it as a rookie. You don't tug on Superman's cape, you don't spit into the wind, and whatever else you think you might do, you definitely don't mess around with Bogus. But Moon had a plan. He plotted to hide Bogus's beloved horn, a beautiful black coronet, in the trunk of a car on the showroom floor. Bogus immediately noted its absence and just as quickly found it, having no doubt who hid it. Then he hid it again. The sage was set. Let the show begin. Enter Bogus acting as if he had come completely unglued. Somebody better bring me my coronet. I make money with that horn. You don't mess with my money. Moon smugly mocked Bogus. Hey, man, don't come unglued. He then sauntered confidently to the crime scene. He calmly turned the key, stared straight into the abyss of an empty trunk, and turned white as a sheet. The hook was set. Bogus owned Moon, and he knew it. Bogus exploded. He angrily handed him the yellow pages and insisted he call every pawn shop in town. Moon, having little choice, obeyed. Bogus then got his own phone book out, went to the middle of the alphabet, and got a pawn shop owner in on the gag. So when Moon called that one, the owner replied, "Sure do, bought a horn just like that just a few minutes ago. I'll take $300 for it." Moon almost passed out. $300 in the mid-70s was way more than he could afford. Then poor Moon promptly came unglued. Bogus showed no mercy. It was like watching Snoopy and the Red Baron. Then as Moon made the long walk to the car to drive to the pawn shop, Bogus finally let him off the hook over the loudspeaker. In those days, the hours were just awful. It was 6 days a week, minimum 8 hours a day. Summers were even worse. We worked alternating 12-hour days, particularly horrible when your late nights were on Monday, Wednesday, and Friday. In the summer of 76, one beautiful Thursday evening, I was so excited to leave at 5:30. It was so beautiful, I hesitated long enough to put the top down. That was a big mistake. That gave the manager just time enough to catch me. I had a customer waiting. I vowed to myself to run this customer off with all of the intentional rudeness I could muster. I wanted to go home. Inside, a small Asian man awaited. His name I will never forget. Toy Kong Pham. He immediately took control of me, insisting that I take the car across town to show his wife. I wondered if I would ever get home. Back at the dealership, he dillied, then he dallied as he slowly made his decision. When things ran in his favor, his English was flawless. Otherwise, he feigned confusion. It was unnerving. He was still vacillating when the store closed at 9. He ultimately signed on the dotted line at 9:45, and I finally prepared to go home. Then I couldn't find my keys. And all the reparking and hustle and bustle, I'd lost them somewhere. Bogus tried to help. We started by searching my desk, drawer by drawer. He asked me where all I'd been. I said, where all I'd been? Hell, fam dragged me all over the dealership. He wanted to see the service department, the body shop, the parts department. Where hadn't I been? Patiently, Bogus stuck with me every step of the way as I revisited each spot. I was distraught. I'd been there 14 hours on my early day. I just wanted to go home. Finally, we returned to my office to check once more, and there they were in the same desk drawer where we started. Bogus had hit them there. 10:30 p.m., unglued, I finally headed home. 10 short hours later, I returned for my third 12-plus hour day in a row. The bank called back very quickly. They weren't touching Toy Kong Pham with a 10-foot pole. He was a Vietnamese refugee, not a citizen, too much of a flight risk. It had all been for naught. Several months later, I moved to Utah for a couple of years, sold cars there for a bit, and then got out of the car business altogether. But I just couldn't seem to find a job that paid enough money, so ultimately in 1981, I again relapsed into the car business. Within days, standing on that same showroom, I spied a customer that I knew in a flash was the immortal Toy Kong Pham. 5 years later, I instantly recognized him. I stood tall and gathered myself up and did what any truly professional car salesman would do. I hid in the bathroom. I emerged. Pham was still unattended. I returned to the bathroom. At this point, I didn't care if everyone in the place thought I had diarrhea. I was not going back out there. The next peek revealed that my friend Larry Mosher was waiting on him. To my amazement, with no hassle whatsoever, Pham just bought a car. It took maybe an hour. And now a citizen employed full-time as an engineer, the bank cheerfully approved. Just like that, Mosher earned an easy sale and a nice commission. Or so it seemed. With the deal done, it would only take an hour or so to get the car ready, so Toy Kong Pham kept shopping. Minutes later, he called from a competitor showroom floor telling Mosher that they were willing to throw in the floor mats. As a side note, the floor mats in question were the cheapies. No one would ever have worried about throwing them in. Had Pham just asked for them up front, Mosher would gladly have conceded them and his commission would have suffered a mere $4. Now, after the deal, Mosher would have to pay full price for them, not exactly a deal breaker at $16. Instead, Mosher stood his ground. If you are a man of honor, you'll keep your word and come get your new car, adding, and I quote, "But my wife and I are not going to buy you a set of floor mats." Well, Pham was not a man of his word. He bought the car right there where he sat. All because Mosher, now forevermore to be called Mats, would not throw in the cheapy floor mats. To this day, he still holds the honor of being the only car salesman in history to give up a deal over a $16 set of floor mats. And for as long as Pham stayed at that job, Mats continued a weekly ritual. He'd get this childlike excitement in saying something like, "Oh, it's time." And he'd run to his desk and dial the number. "Toy Kong Pham? Yes." That was long before caller ID. That dealership has long since moved. The building is still there. Bogus passed away years ago. I've lost touch with Mats and most of the group. Peter Paul is still in the business and tells me it's much better now. Perhaps one day I'll relapse and try again, but until then I'll ask for God's deliverance one day at a time.